1 week ago tonight, South Florida stunned Notre Dame. 1 week ago tonight, Ball State upset Indiana. What surprises are in store this evening? The Bulls and the Cardinals play next.
On a hot, steamy, late summer night in South Florida, USF from the Big East welcomes Ball State from the back. Both teams sporting undefeated records in this very young season. Greetings, I'm Jim Barber. Here's the coach, Doug Graber. This is a home-and-home series that will end up in Muncie next year of September. In the meantime, the winner tonight goes 2-0 on the season. So is it too early to tell, coach, about the potential of a good year for this winner?
Well, I don't think so at all. I think for Ball State, I've coached at Ball State. Beating Indiana is huge. And by the way, that's the second time in a row they've beat Indiana. That can definitely really get them going. They needed a big win like that. For South Florida, beating Notre Dame at Notre Dame, it's Notre Dame. Right away, they jump up in the AP poll to number 22. A great confidence boost for this really still young football team definitely can help them.
Let's talk quarterbacks. Let's talk Keith Wenning, the super sophomore from Ball State, who actually last week put together some numbers turnover-free that were dazzling. What about his game did you like?
Well, first of all, he's 6'4", 220. He's very accurate. He's got a lot of poise for a young quarterback. 10 of 14 on third downs last week was Ball State. That was the key factor in that win.
B.J. Daniels on the other side has got a strong arm, can run the option, can hit the bubble screen. How is his game progressing at this point?
Well, this is his third year as a starter. Very, very solid, tremendously athletic quarterback. He played very well last week, too. Zero turnovers, managed the offense extremely well.
The passing of Leroy Selman has rocked the Tampa area. You had a chance to attend funeral services on Friday. What has the mood been like?
Well, it's been a very, very tough week in Tampa, Florida, and also for USF, I might add. Absolutely the most beloved sports figure this town has ever had. A Hall of Fame football player, but that's a small part of Leroy Selman. A Hall of Fame person. If they had a Hall of Fame for human beings, he'd be the first one in. Unbelievable, unbelievable person. We're all going to miss him just dearly.
Tonight's Big East game is brought to you by the 2012 ESPN National Golf Challenge. Go to ESPNGolf.com to sign up today.
Ah, the Pirate Ship here, ready for the Buccaneers tomorrow and the Lions, the National Football League.
And the Palm Trees, spectacular night in South Florida. Pete Lembo's been here before with Elon back in 2007 and took a most underrated team at that time and nearly shocked the world and beat USF. First season of Ball State head coach, and again won his opener on neutral ground last week in Indianapolis at Lucas Oil Stadium. Skip Holtz, it's been a very trying week for his team. After this six-hour game at Notre Dame due to the weather problems, they got back at 4 a.m. and then the shocking news of Selman's death, a short week. We'll get into that as we go along, but feels still pretty good about his football team and also feels that if they've got their mindset for tonight, they should be okay. About 150 miles out, the weather forecast is good. Doug, that's a surprise because yesterday storms, today storms, but it's Florida, right?
Well, it's Tampa. It's, September. I mean, that's what it is.
So we get set to play football, and Ball State goes on offense first. The Bulls won the toss and deferred. Marvin Kloss, who had one touchback in that game against Notre Dame last week, is set to kick off.
You know, and the special teams tonight is one area where you have to give an edge to South Florida. They have two phenomenal return guys. A very good kicker, very good team speed. Should be a slight edge to South Florida.
Rick Zorsbaan, number one, and number two, Jamil Smith, are deep for Ball State, and we are underway. From the goal line. And the Cardinal return. Oh. is taken away by South Florida for a touchdown. The takeaway magic from last week has extended itself to this game.
Well, that was an absolutely unbelievable collision on the opening kickoff. I mean, wow. Watch that hit right there. That was amazing. And that, by the way, was Rashard Clyett that makes that hit. And he is a true freshman and an amazing football player for South Florida.
26, Mark Joyce returned it for a touchdown. That's six turnovers that USF has caused in a little more than one game. This is a very dangerous team that practices, as you know, Doug, because you're from this area, the scoop and score method, which is strip the football, or in this case, deliver a hard knock, pick it up, and go the distance.
Well, they practice it every single day, and they're very, very good at it. But boy, that collision right there, unbelievable. Take a look at the Big East preseason poll. USF picked third. West Virginia, of course, picked to win it. Those two teams meet in the final game of the season here at Raymond James.
And many feel that could be for the conference championship. But an electric beginning tonight here in Tampa on the fumble caused and a scoop by Joyce. And 8 seconds in, South Florida has 7 points.
Well, that's not exactly what Coach Lembo had in mind for that opening kickoff. But, you know, this is a very, even on the opening kickoff, this looks to be a very emotional USF team tonight, and of course they have Leroy Selman's number on the back of their helmets, as you can see there when he turns, and insignia on the front. There's Leroy's numbers all over this stadium. I mean, he was beloved by every single kid on that football team.
The former great Tampa Bay Buck, his passing has certainly inspired this football team, and they wear the 63 decal. That was his number here as the first round draft pick of the Bucks back in the mid 70s.
You know, and the only thing I could ever get angry with Leroy, he retired the year before I came here in 1987 as defensive coordinator for the Bucks.
You missed him by a year. To the end zone, and the Cardinals take a knee and will start from their 20. So that's already a better beginning than the first time around.
That was Briggs Orsbon. That was Briggs Orsbon, and that was a very wise decision.
So the Cardinals go on offense, but already in a hole, 7-0.
Orsbon, senior wide receiver, has been a heck of a player. Then, of course, there you see Mr. Keith winning.
His confidence growing day by day under the direction of Pete Lembo and offensive coordinator Rich Skrosky. Bulls showing blitz, winning to the flat. Modest game by Torrey Gibson on the opening play. Let's take a look at the Cardinal offense. They've got a variety of receivers in this hurry-up offense. Look for 85 Jack Tomlinson to be the best at making route cuts and getting open. And the front group, Austin Holtz, will spend some time along with Cameron Lowry shoring up the left tackle position. Craig Hunter is the most spirited guy on this team. He wears 66, and he is the center. Bulls again showing blitz, backing off. Pass complete, and good enough for a Ball State first down to Tomlinson.
Well, as advertised, very, very accurate by Wenning right off the bat.
South Florida's defense led by the super defensive end 97, Ryan Gibbons. The linebackers, Barrington, Linares, very intelligent. And on the defensive side of the secondary, well, last week it was Kayvon Webster with a scoop and score. On first down, incomplete pass by Wenning, who didn't have many of those last week in the victory over Indiana.
And, you know, Mark Snyder, the USF defensive coordinator, he told me yesterday as we looked at tape, he wants to play a lot of pressure defense. He wants to get to Wenning and have some contact with him and see how he handles that.
I'd like to get a rush off the edge. It's something he felt that the Bulls did not do last week against Notre Dame, and well aware of the fact that Wenning was barely touched in his quarterback role last week. for Ball State against Indiana. So Snyder wants to bring the heat, and likely early.
And I love Mark Snyder. I tell you, he has a lot of fun coaching. Former defensive coordinator at Ohio State, the former head coach at Marshall, has done a great job with this defense here in his second year.
On third down, Wenning. Blitz picked up, throwing for the first down and got it. Heath Wenning already tough on third down plays, 2 for 2, and both times 85 Jack Tomlinson, who runs terrific routes, coach.
He really does, and he's very quick and explosive, and this is good protection up front. And again, you can see the throw here, and a nice job by Tomlinson of coming back for the football.
Tomlinson's best numbers all time, 7 catches, 175 yards, 3 scores in a game against Akron last year. On the second, first down of the drive, to the ground. All-State ran for over 200 yards last week. Do you feel that the Cardinals can run the football tonight?
Well, they're going to have to. I mean, and you know, they're going to have to make some throws outside to get Coach Snyder to kind of call off the dogs and not overload the box too much. And that's really the key. And, of course, Coach Skrosky said that in our conference call and again tonight. They have to make some plays outside so South Florida can't overload the box.
Orsbon moving in the slot. He's open, catches the ball near midfield, and extends himself into South Florida territory. The senior receiver with the perfect GPA, Briggs Orsbon on the catch, setting up a third down and most manageable situation for Ball State, and already the Cardinals are 2 for 2 on third downs.
You know, this is going to, I'm warning you, this is going to sound kind of foolish, Jim.
Not coming from
you.
But
a lot of times, the worst thing that can happen to a football team is to have an early score like USF just did on the opening kickoff. And you kind of, you know, you lose your edge a little bit sometimes.
On third and very short. This time, Tomlinson can't make the catch, and so Pete Lembo is faced with an early decision. And he has elected to punt the football away and get field position.
Well, that was a great throw. He hit him right between the 8 and the 5, and that's the play you got to make. And Tomlinson was not able to come up with it right there.
A burner number 10, Terrell Mitchell, is back for the South Florida Bulls. Terrence Mitchell, 5'10 sophomore, and Scott Covanda punted a 57-yarder last week in the win over Indiana, is back to kick for Ball State.
But he's tremendously talented. He's an NFL punter, and boy, he hit an NFL punt right there with great hang time. Wow. I mean, you know, Ball State is punter. They've got 3 now in the NFL.
3.5 minutes in. Great start for the Bulls. They've got the football for the first time on offense, up 7-0. Both teams run a hurry-up offense. It's B.J. Daniels' opportunity to implement South Florida's in this game. But the Bulls ahead 7-0. His numbers last year were decent, except for the right column, the picks 13. And obviously he's off to a good start this year, throwing no interceptions in the win over Notre Dame. In fact, he had 100 total yards in the first half against the Irish. From the shotgun, play fake to the flat. And close to a first down for the Bulls. Mitchell on the receiving end.
Yeah, that was a good open field tackle by Jason Pinkston.
Take a look at the USF offense. They've got plenty of speed. A.J. Love, Sterling Griffin, arguably their best receiver, and Joel Miller as the wideouts. And up front, well, consider this. Lots of experience. Hine is a redshirt senior. They have 17 of their 22 players have redshirted at one point of their career or another. And that's what Pete Lembo eventually wants to do at Ball State. In the meantime, Lembo's team features a 4-3 attack, and Nathan Ollie was the MAC West Defensive Player of the Week, having 2 sacks last week. Linebackers are Martin, Freeman, and Morris, all good ones. We'll get to the secondary in a moment. In the meantime, The Bulls got to the Ball State secondary on the carry by Murray, and it's a first down for South Florida. And this secondary anchors this defense. Garrett Howard, Sean Baker, who's playing cast and all and playing well, and Jason Pinkston, who bodied up on DeMarlo Belcher of Indiana last week and really did a pretty nice job on him. Fake on the end around, the quarterback keep, and Daniels across the 40.
It was no surprise to see USF. Boy, they're coming at a very fast pace right now. This is a little bit unusual for them to go this fast. Ran a lot of bubble screens early so they could read the coverages.
Three wide outs to the far side. Murray carries the football again. And it's a first down for 21, Demetrius Murray, who last year was the team's best rusher at 542 yards for the season.
Well, there were two problems last week for USF against Notre Dame. One, they didn't run the ball nearly as well as they'd like to. And two, their third down conversion percentage was not as well as they'd like to.
On the fake of the end around. Terrific play calling. Shields on the catch. First down for the Bulls inside the 35. And what makes this offense so efficient so far?
Well, a lot of misdirection here early in the game. And they cleared the corner out. And the big tight end released right to the flat and, of course, was wide open.
Cardinals rush five, open receiver, far side of the field. Another sizable gain on first down. And right now, B.J. Daniels is picking apart the secondary. So let's assess Ball State and its future on this drive. What must it do defensively?
Well, one, they better get a little bit of pressure on B.J. Daniels because he is absolutely shredding them. Every throw has been right on the money.
After the catch of Stephen Bravo Brown, the third receiver to make a reception. Up the middle go the Bulls. First down inside the 25 and back to Demetrius Murray, number 21.
Boy, that's South Florida. The offensive line of South Florida is really coming off the football and getting great movement.
Give again to Murray, and he has stood up at the line of scrimmage and might have picked up a yard, but a nice defensive stop.
Yeah, that was Tony Martin, the strong side linebacker that stepped up and made that stop. And there is Andrew Putoff, number 41, and he was in on the hit as well.
Yeah, Putoff was a terrific high school baseball player. In one game, he had two grand slams, 11 runs batted in. Little bubble screen here to Mitchell, and Mitchell down to the 18. And again, the effectiveness of the bubble screens, the reasons for it is to try to find out how the defense is going to line up.
Absolutely, and two, it's to not allow Ball State to get overload the box for the running game. It's all based on setting up the running game because they have so much speed at wide receiver. If they miss a tackle on the bubble screen, it's gone.
Screen to Murray looking for the first down marker. He is going to be marked out of bounds. And the ball is short of the first down by about a yard.
Yeah, and finally a little bit of pressure. That is Baker coming on the blitz. Forced B.J. to get rid of it just a little bit sooner than he would have liked to. And there you see, of course, Skip Holtz and quarterback's coach, Peter Voss, going through the options as we've got the field goal team on the field here.
Mike Combonani will try a 31-yarder. 17 for 21 last year off a broken back the year before.
14 out of 14 inside the 30-yard line.
They're listed officially as a 32-yarder. 10-0 South Florida.
I think the pace of that opening drive really caught Ball State a little bit flat-footed. I mean, that is not their typical game. They went exceedingly fast.
Keith Wedding was 4 for 6 on the opening drive tonight. Last Saturday night, as the coach pointed out, he was flawless on third down, 10 of 14, had zero turnovers, and he had a slew of receivers to find.
Yeah, and remember now, even though he's 6'4", 220, he runs pretty good too, as you saw right there. And great touch on this fade to Connor Ryan in the back corner of the end zone.
In this football game, we are 7 minutes into the opening quarter, do you get a sense of importance for Ball State on the next drive, down 10-0?
Well, you know, it's early. I mean, they moved the ball well on their opening drive. I mean, it's all about that opening kickoff and the touchdown for South Florida. Shocking early touchdown on this game, and that's Pete Lembo right there is very concerned about that. And what a tremendous collision that was. You can hardly fault Ball State return guy. Wow, that was some lick right there.
27, Marvin Claus set to kick off again for South Florida. Orsman to make the catch beyond the five.
Wow.
And the Gunners right there for South Florida to make this a very short return.
Well, you know, the South Florida definitely has a speed advantage in this game, and it shows quicker in the special teams than any place else in the game of football. And both opening kickoffs, it's been very, very evident.
So if you're Ball State, how do you offset some of that speed?
Well, that's kind of tough to do on a kickoff return, I'll tell you that. Maybe it probably a reverse might be the only thing. They might try that.
Full showing blitz and a rush four. Cardinals over 200 yards on the ground last Saturday night in the win over Indiana. Sam Barrington, 36, up to make the stop from his linebacker spot on Edwards' carry. Juwan Edwards with a huge Saturday night against Indiana. Quickly out to the flat and good enough for a first down. Torrey Gibson on the reception. And I suppose that's a way to offset that speed.
Well, absolutely, and that was a great block by number 85 right there. Wow, great chop block. I'm sorry. That was Willie Snead that made that block. But that's really, you know, wide receivers have to block in both of these offenses, and that was a great one, great chop.
13 catches for Torrey Gibson last year. Cardinals with three first downs, no points to show for it. Short passing game effective to fakes. And it's almost like an extension of the run game when you do the dink and dunk.
Well, and that's what they're doing. And I think it's wise because, frankly, I don't think they're going to have enough time to really throw the ball downfield. Although the protection by the Ball State offensive line, that's a veteran offensive line, by the way. 93 starts in that offensive line, and the protection's been pretty darn good so far.
Same fix, played his high school football just outside Indianapolis in Plainfield.
And that was Juwan Edwards, the true freshman running back out of Matthews, North Carolina, that had 84 yards against IU last week.
Wasn't recruited very heavily, and this summer he was available. He and his mom made the visit to the Ball State campus, and the rest was a nice piece of history for the Cardinals. Ball State 2-for-3 on third down conversions.
Third and about three, a long three.
Little option, little toss pass short of the first down marker. Ball State short by about a yard.
Yep, that's the shovel, and that's very well played by the linebackers of South Florida. And by the way, the linebackers, that was D.D. Lattimore that made that tackle. But Lattimore, Linares, and Sam Barrington, they are veteran linebackers and very, very good as a group.
Lattimore had a pick last week in South Bend against the Irish as Mitchell goes back to return. One of the better punt returners in Big East Conference play last year.
You know, and Scott Cavanda, the Ball State punter, now he's got a lot of pressure on him tonight because we've got a flag on the field down by Mitchell to return.
Offense, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Ron Snodgrass heads up this Mid-American Conference officiating crew. And typically the way officials are chosen, the visiting team dictates which conference will have its officials direct the game.
Yeah, a little slow getting out on the punt team. And by the way, I mentioned Ball State being punter. You, Jim, Brad Maynard is now in his 15th year in the NFL, and Reggie Hodges is in his 7th year. And I really believe that this young man, Kavanda, well, he definitely has the potential to be an NFL punter, although that's not what he wants to do right there. And a good South Florida bounce.
Punted the football 121 times over the last two seasons. Obviously, the less you see of Kavanda this year, the better Ball State's fortunes might be. Attention golfers and club pros, online registration is now open for the 2012 ESPN National Golf Challenge. Log on to ESPNGolf.com to sign up and find a participating course near you. Earlier tonight, a moment of silence for number 63 who starred in Tampa a number of years in the National Football League, Leroy Selvin.
One of the greatest defensive linemen that has ever played the game, and unfortunately played on some teams that weren't very good. But people, if you talk to any coach in the National Football League, they would say Leroy Selvin was probably the best.
And you were friends with him for some good 25 years, were you not?
I was an honor to be a friend of Mr. Selvin. That was Mr. Scott here at running back. It makes a good cutback. The number one recruit in the nation a couple years ago out of California, transferred from Colorado to USF.
Little pitch out to the flat. Good enough for a first down and then some. A real concern about South Florida speed. As Victor Mark is on the receiving end, and it's the release of Daniels that's been so impressive already. Pitching a perfect game, 7 for 7.
And very, very quick release, and they were one missed tackle away right there from going the distance. That's the, that is the danger of all these bubble screens that the offense is running out.
Play action for Daniels, shooting one down the field. It could be picked off, and Pinkston makes a terrific interception for Ball State.
Well, that was a miscommunication between the wide receiver and the quarterback. The wide receiver pulled up. Take a look at it. The wide receiver stopped his route. B.J. Daniels thought he was running a fade. And of course, what a great interception by Jason Pinkston. And he is an outstanding, outstanding young cornerback. Tall. He's 6'2". He can really run. He's a great young man out of Cleveland, Ohio.
Making his 16th start tonight for Ball State. Cardinals deep in their own territory, but they have the ball back. From the I formation, winning the throw. That one nearly thrown away, intended for number one, Briggs Orsbon. Let's go back to the pick by Pinkston.
Yeah, take a look at Pinkston here. Does a nice job of judging the football and lands inbounds. He was all Mac last year just as a sophomore. He's a terrific, terrific young football player.
Long and rangy, his coach describes him as. On second and 10. Cardinals dug a hole early on the opening kickoff. Fumble scooped up and scored by the Bulls. Made it 7-0. And then moments earlier, Bonanni with a field goal. Up USF's lead to 10-0.
Tough,
in this
tough,
steamy environment, getting down by two scores early. Not advised.
Well, it's hot up in Indiana in the summers, too. But it's a different kind of heat down here with the humidity. And these teams come in from the Midwest sometimes. By the third quarter, I'll tell you, they really feel it.
They don't call it a dry heat, do they?
This is not a dry heat.
Third and long, winning with time. The Orsbon, the way short of the first down marker. Good coverage by the secondary and linebackers, led by 36 Sam Barrington.
Well, the secondary and linebacker corps for USF is just a veteran group, and they have played a lot of football and played pretty darn well. And they're just all over that one right there. That was the linebacker. That was Barrington right there that made that play. But this linebacker core is smart. They love to play, and they all can really, really run.
Already the third punt of the night coming up by Scott Kavanda. Terrence Mitchell at midfield.
Wow.
This time a better one than previous. Mitchell receives at 39. He's not going anywhere.
Well, that was a directional punt by Kavanda, and he boomed it, and he pinned him right into the sideline. Absolutely no place to go. Great punt.
Which is how the coaches described earlier this week that he must punt to these guys simply because of the great speed of the Bulls. So they're back on offense. Yep. Good field position. Chance to mount another drive, already ahead in this game by 10.
The two return guys for USF, Mitchell and of course Lamar Lindsay, they can fly. Both out of the same high school here in Tampa.
Lamar on the move, back to the ground game. Strong gain on first down as that pile continues to move forward for the Bulls.
Yeah, take a look at this push by this offensive line now. Watch them come off the football right here. Boy, that's the big red. Wow, that is the big redshirt freshman right tackle, number 70, Quinteris Eatman. 6'3", 297. Man, that was impressive.
And this one very close to the marker. Scott, who played 2 years at Colorado, disenchanted there. Friends and family back in the South Florida area came to play football here. They said he was a little over-anxious last week, but as Skip Holtz told us earlier this week, he said, you know, a lot of that had to do with he hadn't played football in a couple of years. Daniels moving around. Still loose. Looking to throw. He's got a receiver. Caught at the 35-yard line.
And that was Lamar crossing the field. And I'll tell you what, this is how B.J. Daniels can hurt you. And this is what defensive coordinator Bateman was worried about. He is just so athletic. Played on the South Florida basketball team as a freshman.
Mac Daniels made a trip to Notre Dame as a freshman basketball player, and they nearly upset the Irish that night. There is an injured Cardinal player back at the 17-yard line. And cramps will be an issue because It is hot tonight. There is much humidity based on the fact we've had a lot of rain the last couple of days. And you mentioned earlier, you train in the Midwest. It gets pretty steamy during the summer, but not Florida hot.
This is a different steamy, believe me. This is a little bit cooler than it's been, to be honest with you, Jim. I mean, this... Yes,
I saw a couple of people reach for their jackets tonight. It's not that cool.
And cramping for the Ball State team and for South Florida. I mean, you know, the weather's the same for both teams. And, you know, when the Bucks play the Detroit Lions here tomorrow at 1 o'clock in the same stadium, there will be some cramping there, too, I promise.
I'd imagine. Big East Conference was perfect last week in 9 games, winning all 9. Not so this week. Louisville lost last night at home to Florida International. Rutgers lost a tough one to Carolina today. Pitt struggled with Maine but won it. West Virginia a slow start and then blew out Norfolk State. Tennessee and Cincinnati were tied at 14 before the Vols got it going. And Syracuse leading late in the fourth at the Dome over Rhode Island 21-14. UConn is just underway in Nashville. First and 10, B.J. Daniels. A rocket to Mitchell. No, he threw a laser.
Well, he sure did. And the Ball State defender made the cardinal mistake of going for the football right there. And that's a horrible mistake. If you go for the football, you better get it.
Daniels 9 for 10, 94 yards and a pick. And carrying the football close to the 15-yard line. As we are down to a minute remaining in the opening quarter, which has been all South Florida.
You know, and B.J. Daniels right there showed, and there you're looking at Baker who made the hit, but Daniels showed now that he's a three-year starter. He just simply got down at the end of that play. Did not take a chance on taking a big hit, and that's exactly what Todd Fitch, the offensive coordinator, wants him to be. Do not put yourself out there and be, you know, and let those people get big hits on you like that. Very nice.
Demetrius Murray in for Scott on the running play. Leaves South Florida with a third down and 5. Possibly the final play of the first quarter. And Daniels again from the familiar gun. Now walks up over center. And we'll take a step back or two. Murray cutting inside. Demetrius Murray carries for what appears to be a first down.
You know, both these backs for USF are big. And Murray is 210. Scott is 240. And they run north and south. And when they make the cut, they don't make a bunch of them. They make one cut and they go north and south.
First quarter officially in the books. Bulls fresh off a victory at Notre Dame, albeit taking 6 hours or so, with a scoop and score early and a two-score lead of 10-0. We have a room with a beautiful view tonight here in South Florida. Jim Barber and Duck Graymer, the former Big East head coach, MAC assistant, NFL coach. Did I leave anything out?
NFL Europe.
You got quite a resume, sir.
All fun, all of it.
And B.J. Daniels, almost a perfect first quarter, minus a pick thrown. Trying to put South Florida into the end zone. On first and 10. Murray carries the football, and he is stood up.
Well, that was a quick power play in the right guard, Estenor, number 60, pulled. And he got submarine, so that really, the play was dead when that happened.
After the pickup of two, back to the ground. Sean Baker 25 to Correll Murray before he can get anything going. Demetrius Murray to get multiple touches tonight, and he had plenty of those, obviously, in a very active first quarter.
Yep. Sean Baker, and that's Armand Dehaney right there, number 13, that collaborated on that hit.
Dehaney, a very good high school long jumper at over 22 feet. Third opportunity on third down for the Bulls. Last week against Notre Dame, not good. 2 of 14.
Big emphasis area here for South Florida this week.
Little hitch and go, and that one, as the receiver got held up, goes incomplete.
The crowd thought that might have been interference. Yeah. There was just a lot of healthy contact out there.
AJ Love thought there was contact as well. You think it's a good no call?
Well, you know, honestly, no. I have to admit, I thought that might have been interference right there. The ball was in the air and there was a lot of contact.
I don't want to put words in your mouth, so thank you. Well, Nanny on to try to convert his second field goal attempt. This would be from just 24 yards out. Tough kid, says the head coach Skip Holtz. Here's Bonanni. 2 years ago, broken back. Last year, wasn't even a starter. Midway the season, they called upon him, and he's been a man ever since. A little more than a minute into the second half. ...69 seconds into the second quarter. Let's take time now to check the MAC scoreboard. And earlier today, Toledo had Ohio State on the ropes before the Buckeyes came back to win at the Shoe, 27-22. Kentucky had a 3-touchdown second half to rally to beat Central Michigan. Eastern Michigan also a winner. This evening, Ohio and Gardner Webber into the second quarter. Western Michigan has a 2-touchdown lead in its game. And Northern Illinois, which will play Wisconsin next week at Soldier Field in Chicago, is tied with Kansas in Lawrence, 7-7. Here our score is 13-0, and for the fourth time tonight, Marvin Kloss is set to kick off for the Bulls.
New return guy for Ball State, Dwayne Donegan, number 45, is back at the left return. Briggs Orsbon is at the right return spot.
Cardinals try to get something going against the speed on these special teams. Better return this time around, up around the 25. Despite the domination of the Bulls, who in the first quarter alone put together 145 yards, it's a two-score game now, albeit it's 13-0, and it's been a dominant performance so far, but to the Cardinals' defensive credit, have held the Bulls to a couple of field goals.
Well, they have. They've played some good defense down in the red zone. And they moved the ball well offensively the first two series, and then they've really kind of bogged down after that, have not been able to run it much at all.
Running the fake to Edwards, out to Jamil Smith in the flat. And Smith across the 30, and gang tackled up around the 34-yard line. Smith is small, but he is quick. He stands all of 5 feet 8 inches.
Well, he's 137 pounds, and honestly, he's no more than that. He is one of the toughest guys I've ever been around. Was a walk-on at Ball State. Very, very smart young man. Good football player, just very small.
2-1 edge for the Bulls in total yards. Quarterback on the pitch to the end around to Smith to the 35-yard line. Jamil Smith is from the Muncie area, and it makes it even a better story when a kid like that can join the university and its football team as a walk-on. I mean, who roots against that?
Third and very short now.
Winning on the quarterback. Keep everybody up front to apply some pressure, and that's going to be close.
This is all going to be on the spot because they did not get any movement.
Jarrell Young came up from his safety spot to try to put a body on it.
That's Julius Forte right there, number 54, that's in on the hit. And Wenning's trying to push that pile. But there's some big bodies in that pile.
Yes. Forte, nicknamed Juju. And on the no gain on the play effort, an upset Pete Lembo. I don't think he liked the spot.
Well, and again, that was going to be the whole deal because, you know, you really couldn't see much from the sideline, whether he got it or not. It was very, very close.
Secor is in the punt for Ball State, not Covanda.
Well, this is interesting, and they're going with a wide, wide formation here on the punt. This may be a rugby punt. Let's see.
Scott Secor, number 31.
And it is.
Nearly blocked. Mitchell will let it go out of bounds, and the Bulls get the football back. Still maintaining an advantage of 13-0. So Ball State's defense has not allowed an offensive touchdown tonight. That's promising, certainly. Let's talk about what they've been able to do as we look at Secor's punt. Defensively, that's kind of limited the Bulls when they get inside the red zone or get close to it.
The best thing they've done is they have not given South Florida any big plays. I mean, any of those 40, 50-yard plays. One scramble, they hit a crossing route for about 18 yards. But other than that, they have not given them big plays, and it's been a bend-but-don't-break philosophy so far.
B.J. Daniels, the quarterback for South Florida, 9 of 11. Back to the ground game, and a sizable gain on first down. Good for more than a first down by Scott. Scott is 240 pounds and simply a load to tackle.
He really is, and look at it here, 240. And he's hit right there, but good balance, and, you know, I really think he was a little bit rusty last week. Hadn't played in about 2 years.
Josh Howard made the initial tackle on the previous play. Daniels back to the ground game. Has the ability to run the option. And again, his total yardage performance in the first half alone in that 16-0 lead in South Bend was substantial.
You know, I really think this fast-paced offense is in this heat. And that's the reason for it. They're trying to wear the Ball State defense down.
Nothing fancy about this offense as Scott carries the football.
You know, and as a transfer, of course, he didn't play last year and really was out most of the year before that with an injury. So he just needs to play. I mean, they've been really excited about him in practice, but he was definitely a little tentative in the Notre Dame game. You know, everything is happening fast. Your heart gets pumping. And he really looks much better here tonight.
Good inside the tackle runner is Scott. He has 5 carries for 37 yards. Play action by Daniels. Avoids the pressure. Finds a receiver.
Oh.
Upended is Scott. But good enough for the first down of the 42 is 20. Joshua Howard came to make the stick.
Josh Howard, young man out of Inkster, Michigan. He made a big hit right here. That's why you don't try to leap over guys. Now LeGarrette Blount can do it, but
right.
I think he's the only one I know of.
Well, and as a result, Scott is down on the sidelines. In the meantime, Daniels with a quick toss to the flat goes incomplete.
That was Aaron Morris, the outside backer, another product of Glenville and Cleveland, Ohio. They have three starters from that high school, Ball State does.
Well, back to what you said earlier about catching the football or running and what you should do when you meet a defender, and that's probably not advisable, and Scott right now is feeling the effects of it on the floor. Demetrius Murray breaks one tackle into the Ball State secondary, and it's another Bulls first down.
Well, it's a good thing for Ball State that Armand Dehaney was able to chase him down, because that was very close to go in the distance. It's a little delay play, and watch Dehaney, come number 13, come in there late and make the play.
14 South Florida first downs, coach, just three for Ball State. Daniels looking down for a receiver, has got one. Another first down to the 15-yard line.
This is the first start now for Lindsay in the slot position for USF, as Miller is hurt with a hamstring. And the way this young man runs, he could be a huge addition to this offense.
Lindsay Lamar with the previous catch, and Demetrius Murray carrying the football, and we have a stoppage of play for the moment.
Yeah, there's a flag down.
Haven't seen many penalty markers to this point.
That was Jason Freeman that made the hit, the middle backer, also from Glenville High School in Cleveland.
No foul for illegal substitution due to the offense subbing. The defense did not have time to react. It is second down.
Ron Snodgrass heading up the MAC officiating team tonight with the explanation. Daniels' numbers most impressive: 11 of 14, 121 yards.
Well, he's made almost every throw has been right on the money, absolutely perfect. Made the one big play on a scramble, which he can do so well.
Skip Holtz was worried about this short week and the passing of Selman and the long game at Notre Dame, the effects it might have on the team. Have you seen any so far?
Honestly, I have not. In fact, the team, if you looked at that opening kickoff, they came out flying. And they even missed their practice yesterday because, of course, they went to the Selman funeral, and the whole team, all of the Buccaneers, by the way, went as well.
How about this? A little shovel pass sets up South Florida. First and goal inside the 5-yard line, and nicely done.
Yep, shovel to the tight end, Shields. And that's another big body going north and south right here, about 250. Very well executed. Boy, Sean Baker has made a ton of tackles for Ball State tonight, broken hand and all.
First and goal, the Ball State 2. To Murray, end zone, touchdown.
What a drive that was. That was really a dominating drive. Well, that's the outside zone play, and he just cuts it back. Wow.
First offensive touchdown of the night for the Bulls. Bonanni on the try for the 20th point. Early second quarter, and the Ball State Cardinals from Muncie, Indiana, are in trouble. Demetrius Murray with his first touchdown of the season, and South Florida has a 20-0 lead. 9:34 remaining in the first half. The CEO of this football team in his second year, Skip Holtz, at East Carolina, with 38-27. His Conference USA champs in 08 and 09, considered one of the brighter young coaches in college football. What makes him so special at this point of his career?
Well, he's very outgoing. He is very smart. He's got a great veteran coaching staff with him. He's a great recruiter. He's a perfect fit for this program. Very enthusiastic, loves it here in Tampa. Got a great family, a very Christian man. He is a perfect fit for this program.
Number one is Briggs Orsbond. Marvin Kloss set to kick again for South Florida. 229 yards on offense tonight and 33 plays for the Bulls. Here's Orsbon from about the three. USF scoring drive, 9 plays, 80 yards, textbook, 2.5 minutes. B.J. Daniels for the night, 12 of 15, a pick and 134 yards.
Boy, that South Florida kickoff team, wow, are they flying.
Can't get to the 20, can you, when you're returning?
Ball State, they can't block them, and there's just so much speed.
Another chance for Keith Wedding and the Cardinal offense. Bulls rush 5, got some pressure, and it's a one hopper to Gibson.
Well, you know, defensive coordinator Mark Snyder was very impressed with Keith Wenning in the tape against Indiana, but they really wanted to see how he would do with a little bit of pressure, and they're starting to bring some now.
You saw pressure from 91 Keith McCaskill, who has a twin brother on this team, and Kevin, and they celebrate a birthday tomorrow. Both will turn 24. It's a veteran team, speaking in South Florida, with a lot of red shirts.
This is Mark Snyder's penny, three-man front, 6 defensive backs package. And he's been so effective with that and runs a lot of different schemes. There you see Coach Snyder. Now he's signaling that's the dime unit now going in.
Meaning?
Meaning that there's 4 defensive linemen now. And of course, the 6 defensive backs, and they brought in, and I'm really anxious to see this young man. They brought in number 16, Richard Clayette, who is a freshman, true freshman linebacker that runs a 10-6, 100 meters. And they are really excited about him.
And they brought the football back to the Bulls.
Yeah, and they brought Clayette off the corner, and wow, what a burst up field. And that was a lot of pressure on Keith Wenning as well.
So a very quick three and out for Keith Wenning and Ball State. And Scott Covanda back to punt again for the Cardinals after Scott Secor took his place on the previous punt.
Yeah, and Secor was in there to run the rugby punt and really had a very effective punt with it. Covanda is more of the traditional style punter, and boy, he hit another good one.
Wow. Sends Mitchell all the way back near the 20. Good open field tackle by the Cardinals. So this time around, on the great play by Jones, Ball State able to pin South Florida back deeper in its own territory. But to this point, it is all USF. Jim Barber, Doug Graber back at South Florida Raymond James Stadium, and some enthusiastic Bulls fans. I imagine a few of them might be around tomorrow to watch the Bucks and Lions christen the 2011 National Football League season. Scott Covanda, moments ago for Ball State, a booming 56-yard punt.
At 44.4 average and great coverage, there's been no returns. That's really keeping Ball State in the game. Good field position mix.
On the play fake, Daniels looking down the field. Got a receiver.
That was Landy, the big tight end. And that's what's called a zone buster. That they ran off the corner. And we got a flag down at the in the backfield. You know what that means. But they ran off the corner and hit Landy underneath. And they had all kinds of time to throw that. Maybe there's a reason they had all kinds of time.
That would have been a 25-yard reception, good for a first down. Instead, the Bulls will be pulled back and pinned back inside their 10. Evan Landy caught a touchdown pass against the Irish last week, good for 2 yards.
Well, B.J. Dan, you see right there, he's so calm in the huddle now. He's played 3 years. He's a veteran quarterback now.
Henley of 8 yards sets up a first and 18. But the Bulls, almost halfway through the second quarter, have been in command from the beginning of the game when they forced a fumble on the opening kickoff, and it was run back for a score.
That's big Donovan Jarrett right there from Hamilton, Ohio, that lost his head on that last play. There's a lot of banging going on in that interior.
Figuratively speaking, of course.
Yeah.
Pick up a 5 on the rush, 2nd and 13. Daniels with pressure, got rid of it. Out to the flat. Shields on the reception.
And that was Baker again. And Baker has a broken hand. His right hand, he broke it in training camp, and he really can't wrap people up. So he's got to chop them down, and he's, you know, he's doing a good job of that. But that's tough for a safety, playing really with your hand all taped up like that. You can't use your fingers.
NFL scouts that have been to Muncie say Baker's got a chance to make it in the league.
Well, he is a very talented guy.
Daniels. First time we've mentioned Sterling Griffin. Good enough for first down as they make up that deficit of 18 yards. Brought about by the holding penalty. And now have a first down beyond the 30.
That's the formation that defensive coordinator Jay Bateman was worried about. Three receivers to one side and Griffin on the weak side. And he's tough to cover out there one-on-one. Another bubble.
A little pitch and catch. And Daniel's so comfortable back in that pocket. And as we mentioned earlier, has such a quick release, so you're not going to get pressure on him in more situations than not. And right now, BJ is just having his way.
Boy, and again, they're going at a very, very fast pace offensively. And I'm absolutely sure this is to wear Ball State down, and I think they're starting to be effective.
Landy with a catch and a first down for South Florida. And Morris is down for the Cardinals.
It's Aaron Morris, outside backer out of Cleveland, Ohio.
Aaron Morris, who had 9 tackles and a sack against Indiana, but this is a different breed of cat tonight here in the Bulls from the Big East.
Yeah, and Ball State is slow getting lined up now. I mean, they're gassed. There's no question about it.
Play fake by Daniels. Throws a bullet. Good for a first down. It's Landy again to the 38 of the Cardinals.
And again, Ball State is really on their heels. They're definitely gassed, hard to get back, hard to get yourself set. You know what, when you get tired mentally, your concentration goes a little bit, Jim. That's what it looks like on this drive.
I think the Cardinals could call a timeout here, perhaps. Landy, again, a first down reception from the 38.
And that was
to the 21. And one of the Cardinals is down.
Yeah, that's Baker. He makes the hit right here. Again, playing without a right hand. And again, you can see he's just trying. He can't use the right hand. He's just trying to chop people and make good hits. And I don't know whether he's cramping or what, but Baker has made a ton of tackles for Ball State tonight.
His coaches say that they'd love to have 11 of this type of player. And they figure with his ability to play special teams in the National Football League, that'll certainly be a plus.
Well, he's the career interception leader at Ball State already. And, you know, he is very athletic. He's got great eyes. He really sees the field well. He's just a playmaker. He makes a lot of plays. And, frankly, if Baker wasn't in that secondary tonight, this score would be different.
This break might be an asset to Ball State, which has been backpedaling for most of this first half. Now gets a breather. Top 25 scores. Not many shockers in the first couple of weeks in college football. Ohio State came back to beat Toledo, Wisconsin. Took advantage of Oregon State early. Most entertaining game was Auburn and Mississippi State in the SEC. Won by Auburn. Michigan State easily 44-0. Alabama had its way on the road at Penn State in a marquee matchup. And South Carolina and Georgia are still playing. 45-42.
Wow.
That game started, I thought, maybe yesterday. It's been a lengthy one. Under 6 minutes, first half. Demetrius Murray stood up and possibly thrown for a loss.
That was Nathan Olley, number 92, right there, playing the three technique. And he absolutely stuffed Jeremiah Warren. Great job by Ali out of Chicago.
Mount Carmel High School. That's a pretty good football program up there.
Yes, it is.
Loss of a yard. Rare situation for the Bulls on offense here in the first half. Down the field. It's up in the air. Incomplete. Good double coverage at the end zone.
That was Quinton Cooper, number 22. that really makes a great play in the slot, gets right under this and with almost picked it. Nice job of him getting under the route.
Well, the Cardinals trail 20-0. They have allowed just one offensive touchdown here in the first half.
Boy, an offensive coordinator, Todd Fitch, is doing them. Now they're in an empty set. Trips to their left, two receivers to their right.
Empty backfield. Incomplete, intended for Demetrius Burry. Throw him a fastball at the 13-yard line.
Well, you know what? That's one of the few bad throws that that Daniels has made. Yes, the ball should have been caught, but still, with a running back
wrong
like
shoulder.
That, yeah, with a running back like that, you got to give him a chance to run with it after he catches
it. Or a little more touch on it, perhaps.
A little more touch, and he had to really turn back for the football.
Mike Combonani on to try to convert yet another field goal. This would be from 38 yards away. Right down the middle. What a weapon he presents on special teams for the Bulls.
Yeah, he's money. You know, and you mentioned his broken back, and that was working a summer job at Busch Gardens, which is right down the street here from the stadium. And as Coach Holtz said, he is a mentally tough guy, and that's why he has so much faith in him as a kicker.
But Doug Graber coached at Rutgers and Ball State, also served as a coordinator with the Tampa Bay Bucks. My name is Jim Barber. Raymond James Stadium is our venue tonight as the MAC meets the Big East. The Cardinals in the visiting white South Florida in its home green.
Well, the one thing that Skip is not going to be happy about here, and I'm sure it will be addressed at halftime, is they have not been able to finish their drives offensively. Just one. They've moved the ball very well. But boy, that Ball State defense in the red zone has made a lot of plays, and that's been a disappointment for USF.
Well, if you remember, that was a similar problem at Notre Dame.
That's exactly right. Benami has kicked way too many field goals for them so far this
yes.
year. Let's see, he had, what, two last week and, three so far tonight?
Yeah. Not likely to hurt them in winning this game because they have a 23-0 advantage, but down the line could be significant. Horsbond from inside the five. Able to break one tackle and returns the ball to the 24 with a shade under 5 minutes for the first half. The cool zone going to work on some hardworking players in the South Florida offense. That front line has given B.J. Daniels a load of time, and that allowed them on a recent drive to go 63 yards in 11 plays and make a field goal.
Yep, and that was Steve Schenkweiler, the offensive line coach. They're hard at work with that group.
Cardinals could use a scoring drive. To the flat and Smith.
Whoa.
And wow. Stood up and dropped. Kayvon Webster, number six.
And that was Willie Snead that totally missed that block that allowed that hit.
Webster with the return of a fumble against Notre Dame last week in the opening moments of 96 yards. This game began in a similar fashion. USF forced a fumble and returned it for a score. For the season now, the Bulls have forced 6 turnovers, Doug, and have committed just one, and that was an errant throw by B.J. Daniels because the receiver held up on his route.
Yep, and again, that was Barrington Scott right there, 33, but just nowhere to run inside him. They're just getting stuffed now by USF front.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, defense, number 2, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
That's against Quentin Washington, and that will help Ball State's cause. That's one of their sizable gains here in the first half, one of the few.
And Skip Holtz will not be pleased with that penalty. And, of course, Pete Lembo's just happy right now. Any way we could move the football and keep our defense off the field, we need to do it.
Last time Lembo was here was 2007. Elon gave South Florida a run for its money, so to speak, that night. And Pete was telling us yesterday in the walkthrough, he said, you know, it was so hot that night that by the time I walked on the field an hour prior to the game, I was soaked. But somehow our guys hung in there and gave them a game.
I did that game, in fact, and I'll tell you, Elon played very well in that game. And then South Florida the following week went up and beat Auburn in overtime at Auburn.
Second and 10, Wenning looks right, throws left, incomplete.
Well, Coach Snyder wanted to get some pressure on Wenning, and he has certainly done it up to this point. Wenning has been very accurate most of his throws, but like all quarterbacks, you get people in his face and that accuracy just kind of disappears. It just makes it very, very difficult.
Wenning is 10 for 15, but just 51 yards, and his longest completion is 10.
Well, number 16, Clyette is in the game to rush from the outside. Here he comes. And down he goes. Wow. That was Claude Davis that made the sack. But boy, Clyette was right. Watch Claude Davis from the top of the screen right here. Great speed rush. And there's Clyette, the freshman, right there with him. Just too much speed coming off the edges. That was Dan Manick that just couldn't handle Davis coming off the edge.
Bulls call a 30-second timeout with 3:20 to go. They're set to get the football back. Inspired group. Already up three scores and then some, 23 to nothing.
Well, it's been a dominant half for USF, starting with that opening kickoff. And again, if Ball State hadn't played such good defense in the red zone, this score would be a lot different.
Holtz's team to face Florida A&M next week. Ball State will be back home for its official home opener in Muncie against Buffalo.
Well, USF has got a chance. They got Florida, then UTEP the week after that, and then they open Big East play. They're ranked 22nd right now. They're going to have a chance to be 4-0 going into the Big East Conference.
Schedule's a tough one at the beginning for the Bulls. 4 of 5 conference games on the road, but then it concludes with 3 straight here at Raymond James.
That was a great directional punt again, and they're not letting Mitchell have any room back there.
Let's address the Bulls program history. The first season of football was in 1997. Leroy Selman had a lot to do with that. You even had a hand in that, did you not?
Well, a little bit, in terms of the staff, and I did that opening game against Kentucky Wesleyan, and when that team came on the field, 52,000 people to watch that game against Kentucky Wesleyan. That was exciting.
As you saw, joined the Big East just a handful of years ago.
And Jim Levitt did a terrific job with this program, recruiting, everything else.
Daniels throwing and completing. Sterling Griffin's second catch of the night. It's a first down for 13 yards. And another look at the way Daniels is pitching the football.
Yeah, and Baker right here makes another tackle. But again, he's playing one-handed, and he's doing a heck of a job. But that's tough.
Baker was on the ground earlier, obviously appears to be okay and back in it. 2 timeouts remaining for the Bulls.
Wow.
And Daniels getting all types of time, starting to load up with the best receiver on this football team, certainly the fastest, in Sterling Griffin.
Yeah, Sterling Griffin out last year with an injury from the summer. A.J. Love, their other starting receiver, missed the whole season with an injury. They really had a problem at the wide receiver spot last year.
To this point, it's too easy, and perhaps you can address why Victor Mark and Griffin are getting so wide open in this game.
Well, it's everything is too fast for Ball State right now. By the way, that was Kyle Hope, the safety, that knocked him out of bounds. But everything is too fast. They can't get any pressure at all on Daniels. They're worn down. They've been on the field all night defensively. No heat, and boy, wow. Daniels is putting on a clinic tonight, isn't he?
Victor Mark, his first touchdown reception of the season, 29-0 South Florida.
No pressure, and look at this throw. Like all the rest of them tonight, perfect. Perfect throw. It's Skip says, nice job, BJ.
In the first half of the Bulls, 371 total yards.
And great protection right here. I'll tell you, that freshman offensive tackle, Eatman, number 70, he has been very impressive tonight. B.J. Daniels has been really impressive tonight. And a nice route by Mark.
Daniels now 22 for 27. These are first half numbers. 271 yards.
Wow.
And a score. And this was not the two-minute drive, the one-minute drive.
Well, I really think there you see Coach Peter Voss talking to BJ, and he is a great young man, great leader, fun to coach. Everybody loves that kid in this program. Young man out of Tallahassee, father's a minister, played basketball here as a freshman, just a great athlete. But right now, that Ball State defense is really sucker win. The fast pace has gotten to them. The heat and humidity have gotten to them. The speed of South Florida has gotten to them. Tough night.
10 points for the Bulls in the first quarter and 20 already in the second. Orsbon on yet another return for the Cardinals.
Well, that's the best they've done. They got out to the 24-yard line, and that's the second time they've been able to get that far.
Cardinals do have all three timeouts remaining, but have been able to muster very little on the offensive side.
You know what? I mean, any rest they can give their defense would be so important right now.
In running the football, 11 tries with the Cardinals and 13 total yards, Coach.
Now they're just getting totally, totally stuffed up front.
Winning to Edwards, and Edwards met at the 20-yard line.
You know, and that play was really a perfect example of speed on defense. In South Florida, every guy that plays out there, the defensive line included, they all can run. All of them could run. That was D.D. Lattimore, number 34, that made that hit. But they can run. All those plays that go to the sideline, they're a bunch of sharks, man, heading to that sideline, heading to the football.
Yeah, that's a good analogy. Loss of two, second and 12. From the edge comes pressure. Winning gets rid of it.
Just a simple Y option route to fakes. A couple yards. You know, you're not going to get any first downs that way. But frankly, take a look at the protection. Got a little bit of time there. Nice throw. Just an option route off of the linebacker. Linebacker plays inside. Tight end goes outside. He and the quarterback have to be on the same page. And there you see Joey Lynch right there, the wide receiver coach, trying to gather the troops up and get something positive going here.
Lively atmosphere here in South Florida. They expect well in excess of 45,000 tonight. And as you might imagine, tailgating began early.
Yep.
In a lot of different spots around Raymond James.
And that student section, 12,500 students, largest student section in the Big East Conference, and they fill it every single week. I don't care what the weather's like. Doesn't matter. Those students are there, and they are very enthusiastic.
Timeout was called by South Florida. Bulls down to one timeout, but a chance to get the ball back.
Yeah, there's that student section. Boy, and they have a lot of fun.
They get on the opposing team. Yeah, they get on the opposing team quickly when it comes into the stadium. Bulls showing blitz. Coming off the edge, high snap. Winning gets loose for the moment, now runs the football. And the ball is loose.
That's the strip drill again. That ball was stripped.
And the Bulls have it.
Yep. Plenty of time, a minute 20. This was started with a bad snap and just got worse.
That's John Legist, number 8. The 7th turnover that the Bulls have caused in what, less than six quarters of football this season?
Yep, and that was Patrick Hampton, the defensive end that came in and kind of knocked that ball out, along with the gist. Great, great field position. The Ball State defense has got to be exhausted right now. Boy, this really puts them in a tough position.
As you might imagine, USF not letting off the gas.
Nope, they're going to go with this no huddle again. Speed it up.
Daniels down the field. You know, South Florida is certainly in the right area for recruiting. You live in this Tampa area. How does it match up against the likes of Florida State, Miami, and others?
Well, of course, they've beaten Miami. They've beaten Florida State. I mean, they've beaten them recruiting, and they've beat them on the field. I mean, they're matching up very well.
In the next couple of years, they'll have both of these teams at home. Daniels on the slant. Cardinals able to hold that up short of the first down. Sterling Griffin on his fourth reception of the night. Less than a minute to go, and the Bulls once again without a huddle.
Third down now. Let's look by Ball State. They're coming.
Daniel steps up, will run, and I believe he got it. The first down, we're speaking of, chance to move the chains again.
Now, that was a nice job at Daniels. Full blitz, had pressure, and that's how he kills you. You know, he's just so athletic. He knew where the yard marker was. He stepped out, he got the first down. A very mature, very poised performance. The one rap I'd have on B.J. Daniels, he's been a little bit inconsistent in the past. But, you know, you take last year in the Meineke Car Care Bowl where he was the MVP and beat Clemson. I mean, he was electric in that game.
And he gets sacked, a rare time that there's been pressure coming on. And Nathan Ali, the Mac West Defensive Player of the Week.
And he's just a true sophomore, played as a freshman. But that young man is very athletic. Watch him 92. Well, that was poor protection. They ran a simple twist and they blew it. The offensive line blew it.
Daniels on the check down, able to get the ball inside the 20. And USF uses its final first half timeout. Could bring on Bonanni here or take another crack at the first down.
You know, I think they probably take one more shot down the field to the end zone. And of course, then they're going to tell Daniels right now, you don't have time to scramble. You got time to make one shot in the end zone.
Can't be brought down because you're out of timeouts.
That's right. And absolutely cannot scramble. The ball has to come out. And then, of course, if it's not complete, well, then you got a pretty darn good kicker to get on the field for you.
Bonanni is 3 for 3 kicking field goals tonight. 3 of 4 against Notre Dame last week.
Boy, you know, it's Daniels. You look at him there talking to the coaches. He's just so poised now. You know, he was redshirted as a freshman, played a little bit and was injured, and then got that redshirt year. And now 3 years as a starter, had some real injury problems last year that he fought his way through. There you see Todd Fitch now down on the field, the offensive coordinator. Along right next to Coach Holtz.
Griffin goes to the far side. Love, Landy, and Shields to the near side. And Scott back to block for his quarterback with 15 seconds left, opening half.
That's what they don't like, Griffin away from the 3-by-1.
Fake by Daniels, looking
can't
to the
scramble.
End zone, and he will throw it away.
Okay, good, good. Good for that. Was good clock management. Got rid of the football, 6 seconds, plenty of time. If it's not there, throw it away, and that's exactly what he did.
Mikon Bonanni, 38-49 in his career. That's well above 75%. Another makeable try, this one from 33. Tonight, converting 31, 24, and 38 yarders. Blocked. Cardinals get pressure. Bonanni goes away empty.
You know, I noticed on their last kick, they had a breakdown, and Ball State capitalized on that, and they brought the heat again. And that's the Brockhaus can there, the holder. Let's take a look. Now, that's just a big paw up inside. That's not a good kick. That's on the kicker. That ball was kicked too low.
So the Cardinals have a second left and something positive to come out of the first half with. '92 Nathan Ali certainly working as hard as he's been able to.
Boy, and those linemen rushing the passer all night long, they are just gassed.
That's it for the first half. South Florida struck early. Jumped out on a defensive touchdown, 7-0, and leads at the break, 30 to nothing. Our game of the Big East Network tonight, easily as dominant as the score might indicate, South Florida 30 and Ball State nothing. Jim Barber back with Doug Graber here in South Florida at Raymond James Stadium. And where do we begin in expressing opinions and thoughts of the first half? How about first downs for openers? 25-4 South Florida. If you knew nothing about the score, you could start there. Are you surprised at this difference in the game?
Well, I thought that Ball State would move the football a little bit better offensively. They did early, but boy, I'll tell you, South Florida has totally shut them down from the middle of the first quarter on. The opening kickoff, I mean, it all started bad for Ball State right there, and great for South Florida. What a collision. Pick it up and score. Tough way to start the game. I really think that's something that's been a huge factor tonight is USF has gone at an extremely fast pace on offense. The Ball State defense is totally gassed in this heat and humidity, totally worn down. Daniels has been terrific for South Florida. He has made every throw. He scrambled when he had to. He's been very poised. It's a great half for him.
If you're the Cardinals, is there anything you can take out of the first half, perhaps including the blocked field goal at the end of the second quarter, and convert that into something positive for the second half?
The one positive I see for them, they have not given up big plays on defense. They have played very good red zone defense, forcing four field goal attempts in the red zone. That's been a very good positive. I'm really concerned about their physical condition right now as they go into the second half. I'm sure they have some kids cramping right now. I know they'll have more cramping here in the second half as much as they've been on the field. Offensively, Ball State has to help that defense out. They have to be able to somehow find a way to manufacture first downs and keep that defense off the field.
Bulls head coach Skip Holtz was worried about the edge of his team after what had happened this past week. Looking back on what has happened tonight, should he have been worried?
Well, I can understand why he was worried. It's been a very, very tough week here for this South Florida team. But, boy, it started with that opening kickoff. I mean, they were flying, and their special teams have been flying all night long. Gavanda, the punter for Ball State, has been a very good positive factor for them as well.
We'll get the highlights later in this first halftime presentation. But, again, at the break, South Florida 30 and Ball State nothing. State nothing, the first of two meetings between these two teams. They will meet again in Muncie in September of 2012. Jim Barber and Doug Graber, time now to show you the highlights. And it did not take the Bulls long in this game to get things going. And if you were wondering about the emotional capacity of this football team after the tragic loss of Leroy Selvin, you didn't have to imagine much as this game progressed. This was the only error, I suppose, in the first half by way of B.J. Daniels.
Now, this opening kickoff right here, I mean, wow. I mean, that pretty much says it all. You talk about it was the opening kickoff. Score for the Bulls. Wow, what a start.
That was Mark Joyce with a touchdown, then Demetrius Murray, then the touchdown pass to 15.
Love. Yep.
Victor and Mark. So 30 to nothing. South Florida at halftime. A great opportunity now to go up 2-0. And the Cardinals, what ways can they find to move the football in the second half?
Well, I think they have to continue trying to work the bubble screens outside. He's not going to have a lot of time to throw the ball down the field. We've seen that clearly now. They're going to have to try to work the football underneath. They've got to do something to try to run the football, whether they trick him or whatever they do, but they have not been effective at all there. And you know what? If they don't get going and help their defense a little bit, this could get ugly.
Absolutely. Doug Woolard is the fine director of athletics here at South Florida. When we come back, we'll talk to him about a very emotional week involving the loss of Leroy Selman. The most solemn week for the University of South Florida and the Tampa area with the loss of Leroy Selman, who started Oklahoma and with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers back in the 70s and 80s. Doug Woolard, who is the fine director of athletics at South Florida, joins us. You were not only there for the funeral yesterday, but also services near Oklahoma City today. Tell us what the mood has been like and also the celebration for the life of Leroy Selman.
I will, Jim. You know, it's been an emotional week. Leroy and I spent an hour together 10 days ago in my office, and you know, he was excited about the opportunity at Notre Dame, and then certainly a big win for us at South Bend, and then, you know, the tragic news when we return. But there's been a lot of celebration for the life of Leroy Selman here in his service yesterday. And as you mentioned, I just landed about 10 minutes ago, and the same celebration and the same recognition for a great man today that was in Oklahoma.
You know, Doug, the service here in Tampa, wow. I mean, it was unbelievable. The whole South Florida team and coaching staff, all the Buccaneers, all the old Buccaneers from all over the country, all of the USF people, all the fans. I mean, it was amazing. But I have to tell you, when Dr. Judy Genshaft announced that the Athletic Center was now the Leroy Selman Athletic Center, I had a lot of tears. And a lot of people did.
And, Doug, it's exactly the right thing to do. I mean, we've had over 3,500 student-athletes have entered our building since we built it. And with the Leroy Selman Athletic Center, you know, he stood for integrity and honesty and academic excellence and competitiveness. And you know what? That's what we strive for, all of our student-athletes, to attempt to achieve now every day when they come in that building.
Yeah, it's a tragic loss. And, you know, to me, and I've known Leroy 25 years, I don't know of anybody who ever met Leroy Selman that did not absolutely love him.
Special man. You know, he stands for everything that's right, not only in the great game of football, but he stands for everything that's right in life.
If there is a memory that you have from the Hall of Famer, what might it be?
Family. You know, every time we got together, your family is important to me, and it's certainly one of the most important things to Leroy. And I think there wasn't a time when we didn't get together and talk about family. And if I ever tried to ask him first, I don't think I ever won. I think he always asked me first.
You know, and I mentioned earlier in the broadcast, it's so heartwarming to see all the signs in the stadium and everything tonight. I can go on record and say this because I never coached him, but I coached against him a lot. He was a phenomenal, phenomenal defensive lineman. He was never knocked off. He was so athletic, and he was so nice. He'd pick up the quarterback. I mean, it was classic Leroy.
You know, everybody I think that's ever, Doug, come in touch with him, you know, when they've left, they felt good. They felt better before the time that they spent with him after they left than any time they spent with him. It just, again, just a very, very special individual.
He made everybody want to be a better person. Comment on that.
You know, he really did. I mean, that's one of the comments I think I made, you know, both yesterday and today. And, you know, I said this yesterday, and I said it again today, and I would say it now to our audience. If we could be just a little bit more like Leroy Selman, the world would be a better place.
Absolutely.
Doug, we appreciate your time. I know you made both services. It's been a long day for you, a longer one for the community, and we thank you for sharing some of your thoughts with us.
Guys, you're welcome.
Thank you, Doug.
Doug Woolard, our special guest, will continue at halftime and get you set up for the start of the second half. Teams are back. We're almost set to play football again. In quarter three, South Florida 30 and Ball State nothing. On the Big East Network, first half numbers, as you might expect, one-sided. 289 passing yards for South Florida, almost 100 yards on the ground, averaging more than 7 yards a play and the disparity in first downs, 25-4. When you look back at the first half, is there anything you can pick apart on South Florida's performance and say, you know, it was good, but not as good as it should have been?
Well,
you're a coach. Come on now.
Well, the one thing I would say, honestly, their rushing attempts. I mean, Murray is only averaging 3.8 per rush attempt. He's had 12. Scott is averaging 7.4, but most of that came on that one run. That young guy there has been absolutely spectacular. I mean, there's no other way to describe the first half that he just put in. I don't know how much he'll play in the second half. I'm sure he'll at least start it. But if you're South Florida, you definitely want to run the football, I think, a little bit better. If you're Ball State, you just got to find a way to hang in there.
Let's take a look at the Big East scoreboard, and as we see, majority of the games already finals. You know, a second game doesn't give a clear indicator, but your best guess as we look down the season, where does South Florida stand with the rest of the competition?
Well, I think in the Big East Conference, I feel very strongly that it's going to come down to West Virginia and South Florida, the final game of the season, right here in December, right in the Raymond James Stadium. Talking to Coach Holtz, these first four games, their total emphasis right now is just get better every single week. In the past, South Florida's had some issues with playing up and down and playing to their competition at times. And that has been a huge, huge emphasis of Coach Holtz right there, to get better every week, to play every week like your life counts on it. They're playing that well, that way tonight, and you got to give Coach some credit. He's done a very nice job. There you see Coach Bateman, the defensive coordinator, and Coach Lembo. And it's no fun to be on that sideline. It's no fun to be the defensive coordinator and watch your troops out there absolutely physically, you know, right on the edge right now. I mean, they have just been beat down. You know, they're cramping. It's tough. The offense hasn't been able to execute much at all. And they're tired.
And the heat continues to be a part of the factor here in South Florida. Lots of weather the last couple days. It has settled down nicely this evening. But it's still hot and it's still sticky. And we will see a lot of South Florida players here in the second half. Short kick to the up man at the 22.
Well, that was the lob kick, and that's the intent. And there you see Coach Lembo right now. And I think he's a great fit, Jim, for Ball State. He's won at every single level. You know, he's ridden the buses. I mean, you know, I really compare him a lot to Jerry Kill, who just went from Northern Illinois to the University of Minnesota. Same thing. All he does is win every place he goes.
And people are asking why such an advantage with this coaching staff together that he has brought over for the job at Ball State, which allowed them a decent little edge against Indiana in its opening victory at Lucas Oil Stadium in Indianapolis. He says, well, you know, we just have good chemistry and the kids feed off of it. And when you've got guys that like what we're doing and we know that we're staying on a similar page, all of his coaches,
right,
makes it easier for everybody else to jump on board.
You know, and let's be honest, I mean, this is a top 22 team that they're playing here tonight without question, and maybe even better than that. This is a complete football team that they're playing.
Demetrius Murray already has a rush for touchdown. B.J. Daniels for the night, just over 300 yards, 25 for 32 in the air, and a score.
You know, and the one interception he did throw, I don't know. It was definitely a miscommunication with the wide receiver. I mean, you know, the wide receiver broke the route off. You know, it was an option route.
Daniels fires a strike.
Wow.
And again, poor Sean Baker playing with playing without a right hand out there. He's making tackles. I don't know how he does it, but he hasn't missed any that I've seen.
Shields' fourth catch of the night.
Boy, did you see that? Daniels looked the safety off right there. I mean, that's a veteran move right there by the quarterback.
Nine different receivers tonight have caught the football for B.J. Daniels. And if you're the Cardinals, how much does this game serve as a measuring stick for where you want to be?
Well, certainly speed-wise and everything else. And Pete has mentioned that. He said South Florida is where we want to go. All the South Florida players, most of them are all redshirted. They all have more experience. They have great depth. This is where Ball State wants to go.
Wow. Great catch by Terrence Mitchell inside the 25-yard line.
Well, you know what? This is a direct result of absolutely no pressure whatsoever. None. And you can see it right there with Freeman and Putoff. They're dead on their feet. They just can't rush the quarterback.
Daniels have been sacked once tonight. To the end zone. Incomplete.
Nice job by the corner, Jeff Garrett. Really, really well played. Got his head back for the football late. Textbook. Textbook by the cornerback. Nice job him getting inside position. I mean, if anybody was going to come down with the football, it was going to be Jeff Garrett.
He is a sophomore from Indianapolis who had 7 tackles in the win over Indiana. The most unusual drop out of the backfield by Demetrius Murray.
And that was number 99, Big Adam Morris, that was hustling over there, and he's the nose tackle. I think on the Ball State defense, Morris and Ollie inside are really, and Baker, of course. And, of course, Pinkston is a heck of a football player as well. But those two inside tackles have played a lot of football tonight, played pretty darn well.
Cardinals with an extra defender. And B.J. Daniels thought he should have had his receiver, who was open at about the 7.
Well, that's another option route, and that's one thing you don't like about about option routes. He had an option to go in or out. He went in. Daniels threw the ball out. You know, you got to get on the same page on it. There you see the conversation going with Coach Phil McGinn. That's the wide receiver coach.
This would be Bonanni's longest field goal attempt of the night.
Just missed a 52-yarder last week. Had the distance. Just drifted off.
And that one misses badly. So his last two kicks, one has been blocked, and a kick that is far away from conversion. Still, it's 30-0 South Florida. Empty possession for the Bulls, and Ball State back to the offense upon our return. Second season, and this is hardly a surprise, as B.J. Daniels will likely get a rest in the next series, and Bobby Evell will come in to direct the Bulls offense.
It's a good opening play for winning. There you see Coach Peter Voss talking to Evald. And, of course, you know, he's played a little as a true freshman last year. He led USF in the second half to the win over Miami in overtime.
Has had some success on the field in big-time atmospheres. Keith Wenning still pitching, a quarterback for Ball State. Scott, the ball carrier.
Yep, that should be a first down, and I think that is the first down since the first quarter for Ball State. Scott, the true freshman.
South Florida with a 28-5 edge in first downs, and that's not the only category where they've been quite good. Well, Scott is Ball State's top rusher with 19 yards. That's how good the Bulls defense has been. In his 7 carries. Out of the backfield, the fake by Wenning and the toss.
Well, you know, South Florida just closes so fast on the football. Fakes looked like he might have a chance to get maybe 10 yards on that, and wham, you know, they just get there. They just run so well, and of course, football in this state here, you look at the numbers for winning. I mean, the numbers aren't bad, but 65 yards have not been able to get the ball down the field at all.
Yeah, which was a big concern during the week, trying to get some separation, and it's been almost impossible to get into that Bulls secondary.
And then when they do, they don't have time.
Bulls putting up 7-8 in the box to try to stop the run, which they do. No gain on that play as we have reached the 11-minute mark of the third quarter. Let's take a look at the Bulls' front line defense.
Yeah, just, you know, great penetration. And, again, that is Lattimore right there that sees the gap. Lattimore and Sam Barrington in on the tackle together. These linebackers are something, you know. And 17 seniors on this USF team and a lot of really good football players out on that field right now defensively. Again, that was Lattimore. Just a great job of reading routes, getting to the football. Very well coached is this defense by Mark Snyder and his whole defensive staff. Yeah, look at that. I mean, that, oh, my. What a unbelievable collision there. Quentin Washington in the corner as well. And there you see Lattimore. But that was a very, very tough hit on the tight end.
D.D. Lattimore was second best in tackles last year for South Florida as another Cardinal has gone down. He had seven tackles last week in the win at Notre Dame. Also had an interception. And you're almost hard-pressed to pick the part of the defense that's the best. Is it the front line, the linebackers, or a very fast and efficient secondary?
Well, certainly the linebackers in the secondary are the strength of this team. And that is, wow, that is a really tough decision or hit on fakes, and he's up on his feet. Boy, is that good to see. That was some collision right there, a dangerous collision.
Big tight end at 6'3 and 233 pounds.
You know, the defensive tackles, I think, are solid. Honestly, I think that the defensive ends are really new, and frankly, they're looking for a lot more production out of them than they've got in the first two games.
Terrence Mitchell is back for South Florida. Ball State will charter immediately out of South Florida when this game concludes. And into Muncie. Here's Covanda.
Great hang time. Pin him right into the corner. What a great kick. Great directional kick.
Scoreless third quarter, at least to this point, but South Florida has a 30-zip lead. ...thousand career passing yards for the Bulls.
Well, every throw here is right on the money. Take a look at it. I mean, every single, look at this. He looks the safety off, perfect throw to Shields. What a night he's had. And, yes, it is Eval down the field and B.J. Daniels. We won't see him the rest of this evening. He's done enough.
So the new quarterback is Bobby Eval. Big quarterback, too, at 6'5", 206 pounds, and a sophomore.
Outstanding baseball player, big arm. It was a walk-on last year. Played in some. B.J. Daniels had some injury problems. He started the Pittsburgh game, played the whole game, last game of the season. Came off the bench against Miami and led this team to a 23-20 overtime win against Miami at Miami. So he's done some very good things.
On the rollout, first pass completion for him. A little shy of the first down. It'll be third and most short. B.J. Daniels has the rest of the night off after a 27 for 37 showing, 335 yards and a touchdown.
Well, big night for him and a great win last week. And he's just a junior, folks.
Most manageable schedule for South Florida the rest of the non-conference play. And then it gets a little tough. How about the run here that is still going? It's going to result in a loss of some significance.
Yeah, I'd say about an 18-yard loss. That was Marcus Shaw, who played some last year as a true freshman. Now, he's the fastest of all the running backs, but Coach Holtz is not happy
Skip
with that.
Skip wants him going north and
all.
South, right?
Yeah. You know, horrible mistake. I mean, when you got a bad play, you got a bad play. Don't make it worse.
Shaw's probably well aware of that as he heads back and has to listen to the coach.
Coach is showing the yardage.
Here's Smith with a fair catch. Good field position for the Cardinals.
Well, thanks to Mr. Shaw.
Yeah. To the back scoreboard, everybody has gone final except for Akron, which is battling Temple tonight. And that game is in the second half, all Temple. The finals, Kentucky down 13-6, came back to beat Central Michigan. Toledo had an early 8-7 lead and eventually had two other leads before Ohio State rallied. Eastern Michigan had a struggle at home, but wins in Ypsilanti. And Buffalo beats Stony Brook 35-7. There are more MAC scores, and we'll deliver them in a second.
You know, I really like the way Coach Holtz coached Marcus Shaw right there. No yelling, no screaming. Okay, go ahead. We'll get the scores here.
And Ohio, these games are current tonight. Ohio leading, Kent State trailing. Western Michigan by three touchdowns, and Northern Illinois a date with unbeaten and eighth-ranked Wisconsin next Saturday afternoon at Soldier Field in Chicago.
You know, but getting back to the coaching discussion, you know, I never felt as a coach that the games were the time to yell and scream at players, and it's non-productive. Coach them, make your point. You know, you don't need to get him any more upset. The young man is upset that he made a mistake already.
How many of these 30-0 deficits were you in as a coach?
I've been in a few.
More than your share, right?
You're not in this business if you don't get in a few of those on the wrong end. I've been on both ends of it, believe me.
Right now, another third and long for the quarterback, Keith Wenning. They're sneaking up their secondary and coming with a blitz. Ball State picks it up, delivers to Smith. That's a first down catch by Jamil Smith, who again is listed at 5'8".
You know, this was great blitz pickup. Take a look at it right here. Wonderful blitz pickup, and that was especially a great job by the freshman Juwan Edwards at running back. Nice job of picking up that blitz. You know, Wenning stays in the pocket. Wenning's going to be a great quarterback. He just hasn't had a chance to show it tonight. Believe me, this young man has got a lot of talent.
Wenning is 16 for 23 and 75 yards. Back the throw again and hit. Ball is loose.
D.D. Lattimore came on the blitz from outside.
Ball State
blind
recovers
side.
Back at midfield.
That Wenning is slow getting up. He took a heck of a shot right there. That was a Kid O'Brien that recovered the fumble, but wow, Wenning took some shot right there.
Lattimore and the Bulls getting a chance to tee off right now with a four touchdown lead.
You don't want to see your quarterback get hit like that from the blind side. That is a breakdown in protection.
You think about the solid game Juwan Edwards had against Indiana, and tonight there is nowhere to go.
Well, you know, it's a tough week for Ball State as well. We've talked about South Florida, but we haven't talked, you know, it's tough coming off a huge emotional win against an in-state rival like that. So, you know, that's all everybody's wanted to talk about all week is the win over Indiana. Sometimes very, very hard to get their focus back.
Wenning out of the pocket and on the roll and throwing and caught. Jack Tomlinson, who made a couple of catches in the first quarter, came back on his route to make the reception.
That was a great throw by Wenning. A nice job of moving in the pocket, finding a spot, and he made a terrific throw.
Cardinals get 15 yards back on the play and now set with a manageable 4th and 3. What's your call here, Doug?
Well, yeah, I mean, you're going to throw it, that's for sure. I would look for some kind of an option route. There's a little 5-yard option route. They've been throwing a lot of them tonight. Let's look. Nope, not. But, man, wow.
Intended for Tomlinson and broken up.
That was Ernie Tabutu. And that was a slant, and that was a great play by the young corner. I mean, he's on Tomlinson, gets that left hand in there, strips the football out. That is textbook corner play.
We have a timeout with 4:15 remaining in the third quarter, and South Florida still pitching a shutout. In our top 25 scoreboard today, many entertaining games. Just one mild upset in the SEC. Auburn beats Mississippi State 41-34. A lot of experts feel number 8 Wisconsin outside chance at a national championship. Where do you reside on that?
I agree. I mean, that one, they've got classic Wisconsin. They got a pretty easy schedule.
Yes.
And that helps. And you know, getting a Russell Wilson was huge. And there you see BJ and Coach Holtz enjoying something on the side. You know, football is supposed to be fun. You know, and I love the South Florida staff because they have fun. They have fun coaching, and the players have fun.
Daniels back in.
Wow. Uh-oh.
And a big-time run by Scott. From the 35.
There's LeGarrette Blount running out, and he'll be on the field tomorrow doing the same thing. That's 240 pounds now, hurdling the safety right here.
That's wow. A pickup of 31, and Daniel's night apparently is not over. He has returned.
Wow. That's surprising. Wow. That's why he was the number one running back in the nation in high school.
So how about Daniels continuing to play? How surprised are you at?
I'm really quite surprised, to be honest with you. I think it's wow, look at that throw. I mean, Brady Hoke is right there to make the tackle, but I mean, that's almost impossible to stop when you're making throws like that.
Victor Mark on the receiving end for a South Florida team ranked 22nd in the Associated Press poll, but the coaches haven't given him any love. Not yet, anyway.
Not yet. By the way, Brady Hoke's uncle is Kyle Hoke's uncle is Brady Hoke, the head coach at Michigan. I coached Kyle Hoke's dad at Ball State. He was an NFL player. He's now the secondary coach for the Bears.
And Hoke's team down 14-0 to the Irish have crept a little closer tonight in Ann Arbor in the first ever night game at Michigan Stadium, 14-7 Notre Dame. About 10 minutes to go in the first half.
Boy, what a get he was for South Florida. You know, the number one running back in the nation out of Ventura, California, went to Colorado, had some issues there, not happy. But transferred to South Florida, sat out last year. Look at that.
Wow. Touchdown, Bulls. Scott bullies his way into the end zone.
He looks so much better this week than he did last week. I think it was just purely a case of a lot of rust from not playing for a year and a half or so. But made a nice cut there. Pretty darn good job by the offensive line. And wow, he knows where the end zone is, that's for sure.
Well, you know, there was a signal for a touchdown from the line judge.
Yep.
But spotted his knee was down
short,
before the
yep.
goal line. So take that score off the board, which had been marked at 36-0. Now on third down, a yard away.
Wow.
It's official now. Touchdown, Scott.
Wow. Yep. Boy, the crowd is they've gotten into this leap, haven't they? Take a look at this. Right over the top of the corner. That's pretty good vertical right there. Look at that. That's amazing.
Got to find out about his hurdling experience back in high school.
You know, most coaches really don't like running backs to hurdle like that. But, you know, what are you going to say as a coach? You know,
Well, maybe Skip Holtz didn't like what he saw from his offense early in the third quarter. The starters back in, or maybe B.J. Daniels just talked him into it.
Yeah, I mean, we saw that conversation on the side. I'll tell you, one bad thing that happened for South Florida in the last series. Number 70, Quinterius Eatman, came out holding his right arm and right shoulder. That's the starting right tackle, the redshirt freshman, who has played very, very well tonight. And that is not good. We hope that that is not too...
A six-play, 65-yard drive, as we saw by the graphic. And with 2 minutes of change to go in the third quarter, South Florida adds to its already huge lead in this game. We're talking about trying to have fun in this game. Skip Holtz shared some of that earlier this week with us. Asked him about contact with his dad, Lou, who coached Notre Dame in a national championship. And he said, you know, after that win at Notre Dame, Dad and I couldn't hook up. So many messages were left, on my phone that my phone went dead.
Yeah, he had so many texts and messages.
Lou was trying to reach him.
That by the time he got to the bus to go to the airport, the phone was dead.
Mm-hmm.
But I loved his comment because, our ESPN, his dad, of course, picked South Florida beat Notre Dame, and Mark Bay picked Notre Dame. And on the interview, Coach Holtz, Skip said, take that, Mark.
And Skip was also saying earlier this week, you know, this job is tough enough. You got to have some things to laugh at occasionally.
Absolutely.
And enjoy, which was your point earlier.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, there's so much money involved in college football now, and I hate that, and I hate that it's become such big business. It's still supposed to be fun. Playing and coaching.
Well, let's assume now that B.J. Daniels' night is done. Suppose we won't know until the next possession. Thirty first downs on the night for the South Florida Bulls.
That is all the number twos in now on the South Florida defense, with the exception of Mike Linares is still in at middle backer. And that is probably they need some veteran out there to to make sure that calls and defenses get called correctly. But now Kayvon Webster, I just noticed, is still in there as well at the wide side of the field, number six. Let's look. Here they come.
8-9 up in the box. Ball State still able to run the football to the chains.
That's Donegan now in at running back, the former walk-on at Ball State. A lot of the backup, some of the backup wide receivers are in the game.
There's Michael Linares, considering a very intelligent player on the South Florida defense.
Solid, solid, solid middle back.
17 of the 22 on two deeps. Red shirts.
Linares had a huge interception in the red zone against Notre Dame last week.
We're actually speaking of the offense, we say all the red shirts, but there are a number of them on defense. And certainly here in South Florida and a lot of other places, that's how you build a winning program. You stockpile.
Absolutely. You know, maturity is such a huge part of this game. And if you have the ability to redshirt young players, it's by the time they come back that second year, they're just totally different.
The other factor not often talked about is that you get a year of schooling, a year to tackle books and stay on top of your classes without playing competitive games.
Yep, should be able to graduate easily, of course, in the 5-year time frame for a redshirt. South Florida is beginning to get to the point where, they have some players come out early for the draft, and that's always a factor, too. But, man, they have had 53 players in their history that have been on NFL rosters. Amazing.
Bulls have had 19 actual draft picks in 14 years, and that number will be going up. So we'll change sides. We won't have to go very far. But we'll go away for a couple minutes. Fourth quarter about ready to commence. Jim Barber, Doug Graber, Mark Snyder on the defensive side of the ball for the Bulls. We get to the fourth quarter. News and notes, Auburn upsets number 16 Mississippi State in a wild one today, 41-34 Dyer, 18 carries, 150 yards. Here's a big upset tonight, third quarter, Fresno State by 6 over Nebraska. In a couple of weeks, Nebraska heads to Wisconsin for a mammoth Big Ten game under the lights at Camp Randall. And under the lights tonight, for the first time in Michigan, 5 minutes to go, second quarter, Irish 14 and Michigan 7. We start the fourth. Ball State on offense. First and 10 from the 45 and winning. Throwing long for Orsbon. And it's picked off. Avon Webster, who had the return for touchdown against Notre Dame. There is a penalty flag back at the 35, but if it's against Ball State, this play should stand.
Yeah, Kayvon Webster, of course, had the 96-yard fumble return.
Personal foul. Roughing the passer.
Oh, boy.
Defense. Number 36. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
Wow.
That will negate, obviously, the interception. I don't know. What do you think?
Wow. You know what? I honestly don't like the call. I mean, he didn't hit him in the head. He didn't hit him high. I mean, the ball was being thrown.
It's on Sam Barrington.
Yeah, that's a tough call in my opinion.
The second Cardinal first down by way of a 15-yard penalty in this game. South Florida trying to protect its shutout right now.
Boy, and Wenning really took a shot right there. I mean, as soon as that ball was gone, he really took a shot.
But you're right, Wenning's a tough kid. Big quarterback, sophomore. Been the starting quarterback since Pete Lembo arrived on campus in Muncie. To the ground, big time gain. Jawan Edwards able to carry the football against South Florida, has backups in at this point, but the most sizable rush of the night by the freshman running back from North Carolina. Here's how it happened.
Yeah, this is just a straight power play, power G, bring the guard, and now he's a big, you know. He's not little. I mean, he's 232, a true freshman. There's a couple of big backs playing for both these teams.
Corey Sykes, David Brown, especially expected to be part of this team. Brown is gone for his career due to a back injury that's not been able to repair. And Corey Sykes continues to fight hand difficulties.
Well, Corey Sykes, I know him well, and he is a flat blazer. I mean, he runs as well as anybody on either one of these teams, and he's a big play waiting to happen. Now take a look at the splits here. Those are tight splits. And again,
meaning
tight splits between the offensive line. If you look, they're really about 8-inch, 10-inch splits.
They're first.
They were trying to draw them offside, but the thing why the splits are so important is when you run the football, you want bigger splits to create gaps. We're going to get to that as we come back from this break, but we're going to talk about that.
Jim Barber and former Big East head coach Doug Graber back with you at Raymond James Stadium. There'll be a quick turnaround when this game is over to get set for the NFL opener for the Bucs tomorrow against the Lions. There's also a fireworks show scheduled right after the conclusion of this game. Ball State in the red zone.
Let's look. This is the check with me. Now South Florida's changed their defense.
Winning from the eye. Give to Edwards, trying to bounce outside. Wow. Touchdown.
Well, this is a great job of the Ball State offense. I tell you what, these kids have taken a pounding tonight, and they've hung in there, and they've just kept playing. That's an outstanding block at the point of attack by the offensive tackle. That was Manic. And, of course, Mark Snyder at USF certainly wanted that shutout for the defense, so he won't be real pleased.
Steve shot on for the extra point. So for two games now, Juwan Edwards has rushed for 125 yards, 41 tonight, and a touchdown.
That was Mershman, number 11, playing fullback, that made the key block right there. He's a converted tight end, quarterback, tight end, and also fullback. Juwan Edwards.
And something positive for Ball State to take on the plane tonight.
Absolutely, and I'll tell you what, you've got to give this team a lot of credit. They have been overmatched tonight. They've hung in there. They've kept playing. The defense has made some plays here in the second half. And, Pete has got to be able to take something very positive from that back. And I would be remiss if I didn't say this. Stan Parrish, who is the guy that recruited most of these young men that are here, and unfortunately had to play a ton of freshmen when he was there. He did a heck of a job at Ball State, and sometimes the timing is just not right. But Pete, I think, has inherited some pretty darn good players. He just needs a lot more depth on this team.
And that will come over time. Lindsay Lamar is the deep return man for South Florida.
Would not be surprised to see another lob kick. Let's see what they do. Well, they kick it away. Try to kick it away from him, but he's going to get it.
And it's Lamar out of bounds.
Look out.
The return from the three up to the 25. Next week in the Big East, Friday night, Iowa State. Huge upset win over Iowa today. Takes on UConn, which has battled back from 14-3 deficit against Vandy, now trailing by a point. West Virginia, Maryland should be a terrific matchup. Same for Pitt against Iowa. Akron and Cincinnati in the state of Ohio. And how about Louisville and Kentucky later in the evening? Syracuse and USC. Pretty good matchups for week three of the Big East. Again, the conference was perfect last week. 9-0, not so perfect today.
Quick throw from Eveld, and nice job by the corner, Jeff Garrett. He's made some nice plays in it. He's a young football player as well, just a sophomore. Played as a true, another one that had to play as a true freshman.
And the philosophy of Pete Lembo will be to try to redshirt a number of these freshmen as Eveld throws incomplete. Put some Ball State players on the shelf for a year, allow them to get older.
Yep.
And then by the time they redshirt juniors and seniors, now you've got the formidable team, and not only in the MAC, but maybe in the Midwest.
I see some good football players on this Ball State defense. They're a little overmatched tonight, but there's some good football players. They'll be very competitive in the MAC.
And the Bulls will have to give up the ball. We can't tell the South Florida's up 30, can you?
No. And this is a great opportunity to get your quarterback some live action. And you have to let him throw the football some. I mean, if he has to go in like he did late against Miami, he's got to be prepared. He's got to get some experience.
Smith on the fair catch beyond his own 25. Cardinals finally got into the end zone in the fourth, and they've got the ball back once again. Juwan Edwards wasn't highly recruited, but the freshman out of Matthews, North Carolina, for Ball State has the lone touchdown. He also has 41 yards on the ground. Let's assess his run for score and also his other running in the game. And what do you like about it?
I like his vision. He sees the things. He cuts back. He can make people miss. He's big. He's strong. I can see how he got 84 yards against Indiana last week. He hasn't had much of a chance, honestly, tonight. I mean, but when he has, when he's had a crack, he's taken it.
His mom came up with him for a visit to Muncie and agreed to jump on the Ball State campus, for which the Cardinals are grateful. Figures very much in Ball State's future. Donegan 45 on the rush there for Ball State. It's a long night for the Cardinals. They'll jump on the plane right when the game is over and return to Muncie deep in the night and get set for their home opener next Saturday night.
Big one too, Buffalo. That's a big Mac game early in the season.
Torrey Gibson on the reception.
Pass complete to number 12, Tony Gibson.
Here you see Coach Snyder gonna give the signals.
Mark Snyder hired back on January 10th of 2010.
Great hire by Skip Holtz. I mean, not a good one, a great one.
Spent some time with Jim Tressel a few years back. Smith in motion, little shovel pass.
I'm amazed. That little guy, 138 pounds.
I think he's really 5'8".
No. And he's packing it up in there like he thinks he's a 240-pound running back. I tell you, what a kid.
Fearless, isn't he?
He is fearless.
Again, a walk-on from Muncie, hometown Muncie, Indiana. And Scott Covanda back to punt yet another time.
He's done a great job tonight, either one, hanging the football up, or two, directional punting. I mean, Terrence Mitchell's had no room to do anything.
Covanda's seventh punt of the night, and for a team, Ball State's eighth.
That's his poorest punt of the night. Didn't get it to turnover.
10:46 for the game. On Sunday, Leroy Selman, who started with the Tampa Bay Bucks and the Oklahoma Sooners, passed away unexpectedly. He was a hero here in the Tampa area, Hall of Famer. First overall draft pick by the Bucks in 1976, the 1979 NFL Defensive Player of the Year, and a good friend of yours, was he not?
Humble, kind, gracious, warm, strong, never angry. And he loved helping people. An amazing human being.
Darryl Scott remains in the game for South Florida. And we'll see 63 a lot on campus, and deservedly so. That was his number when he played for the Bucks. And this field is certainly a part of that and the memories. There was a moment of silence prior to the game tonight and a feature of his life that was put together, package on the scoreboard, which drew a huge ovation.
And there will be a huge celebration of Leroy's life and everything he accomplished here at the Bucks game as well tomorrow. And it was heartwarming at the service here in Tampa to see all, and I mean all, of the old Bucks came from all over the country to be there to honor Leroy Selman. We've got an injury on the field.
And as we talked about at halftime, the Athletic Center now to be named the Leroy Selman Athletic Center. That was officially voted on unanimously by the Board of Trustees and announced at the funeral services in Lutz, Florida, just a day ago or so.
Yeah, and it was an amazing service. I don't know the numbers, but at least 2,500 people there. It was packed. Boy, and that is not good. That is Nathan Ollie, and I don't know what they're looking at, whether it's his ankle or his knee. I hope it's his ankle. That's good to see him up and walking pretty good, because that young guy's got a great future. That's good to see. He's walking off in pretty good shape right there.
A couple of sacks against Indiana in the win last Saturday night, 27-20, but this was certainly a step up in talent tonight.
Yep.
For the Cardinals against a most difficult opponent.
You know, what was kind of sad at the service was so many of the old Bucks that came in, and it was sad to see how many of them struggled walking. I mean, football is a tough game, and I'm the NFL has got to do more for the old players in the NFL. I mean, a lot of those guys are hurting with back problems, knee problems, concussion problems, and boy, I just feel so strongly about that.
Well, you coach in the National Football League with the Bucks, you know what it's like, or what it's been like.
Well, that's a great punt by Brockhaus Khan,
who hasn't had to punt much tonight. Tonight's Big East game is brought to you by the 6th Annual Old Spice Classic, November 24th through 27th in Orlando, Florida. Good place to be around Thanksgiving. Disney World, 18 field. Wake Forest, DePaul, Dayton, very good Fairfield team from last year, all amongst the field. Here we're under 10 minutes for the game. Ball State has scored a fourth quarter touchdown. And Connor Ryan on the catch and run has a sizable first down. Ryan had that big catch last week against Indiana for a touchdown where he laid out in the end zone.
But I'll tell you, on that particular play right there, you see Connor Ryan heading out. But if you can get, folks, just watch number 16. The left of your screen right there. Watch him run. That is a linebacker that's a true freshman. 10-600 meter in high school. Wow. I mean, he ran down a wide receiver.
Rashard Client, big time hitter too. And the next great linebacker, so everybody feels here.
Yes, absolutely. And they've had a bunch of them. They've got a bunch of them that are playing in the NFL right now. You know, with what's happened today in college football, you would think that South Florida will have an opportunity to bump up some in the AP poll. Mississippi State was 16. They've gotten beat. Notre Dame is now leading Michigan, 17-7, I believe.
Halftime.
I think in the next couple weeks, they're going to have an opportunity at least to bump up pretty good.
You would think they'd be recognized by the coaches this week. They're right on the fringe of a top 25 vote. That's one up for grabs and out of bounds.
And now this is a total backup defense in for USF now at every single position.
This, by the way, is the best ranking South Florida has had early in the season at the 22nd spot that Doug referred to.
Big old number 96 there. That is Anthony Hill, big defensive tackle.
Bulls come with four and able to make the stick before Ball State can get to the chains.
It's Mike June.
Even against the second unit, it's been hard for Ball State to move the ball.
I mean, they just, you know, it's Florida. And most of these kids are from Florida and Georgia. And, you know, they play football year-round here, and speed is... It's a speed game. That's the way the game has evolved, and there's tremendous speed in this state in the high schools.
Pays to recruit in this area.
Another great punt.
Bulls will let that one go wisely into the end zone. It does go. 7:46 remaining in the fourth quarter. Upcoming schedule for the Bulls: Florida A&M next Saturday, then UTEP the following Saturday, and then it gets rough. For the next five on the road in the Big East, starting with Pitt on a special Thursday night game over at UConn, then home to Cincinnati at Rutgers. The good news for the Bulls is that the final three games of the season, all the Big East conference, are all at Raymond James.
Don't have to play any place in cold weather, because these Florida kids don't want to do that either, I promise you.
Well, that is a promising schedule, isn't it?
Yes, it is. That is still Darryl Scott in the game. And again, he hasn't played in about a year and a half, so they're going to get him a lot of reps.
Gain of five, second and five.
That's their
almost
second.
A backwards pass.
Yeah, it was. It's totally their second. That's Armand Dehaney right there. Quite a young man.
Raymond James Stadium, our place tonight in Tampa, Florida. Late summer night game between Ball State for the MAC and South Florida from the Big East. Jim Barber, Doug Graber, bringing you home for the final 7 minutes of our game. Eval on a strike to Terrence Mitchell. And that is good enough for a first down, and there have been a bunch tonight for South Florida. 31 first downs and counting.
You know, South Florida had to make some big decisions tonight about some young wide receivers, Andre Davis and Ruben Gonzalez, two true freshmen. I have not seen them in there, which would indicate that they're probably going to be redshirted. But, boy, they're excited about their talent.
And just adds to the stockpiling that the Bulls have done here, which makes their team more experienced over time and more mature. And very difficult to handle. Of course, if you're coming out of high school and you want to play immediately and your coach is telling you, let's consider redshirting, that's a tough call.
Yeah, it is. You know, I'm impressed the way Ball State is. Wow, what an interception.
Josh Howard playing center field there for the Cardinals with a pick.
I'm impressed with it. You know, Ball State, I'll tell you, these kids are playing hard. They haven't quit. Ball's tipped, high throw. Great interception by Josh Howard. Not a good one. That's a great one. That's the old tip drill that all of us coaches always use, and every once in a while it manifests itself.
And that is the second turnover of the night by the Bulls, who also have had two takeaways, one resulting in a touchdown return on a kickoff that started our game. Still, for 2 weeks of work, the Bulls are a plus five in a category that most people measure success by. Keith Wenning remains in the game at quarterback for the Cardinals. Kelly Page is a more than sufficient backup, but we have not seen number five tonight.
Dwayne Donegan, Willie Snead, number 11, Aaron Mershman. How about Ball State? Played in an NFL stadium 2 weeks in a row. Lucas Oil and now Raymond James.
Gonna be spoiled, don't you think?
I would think so.
Next week they'll return to Schumann Stadium to start their home schedule. We'll bring that to you here shortly.
I think Ball State Athletic Director Tom Collins, I really think he made an excellent hire with Pete Lembo. A lot of people don't have enough courage to, you know, bring in a coach from the FCS. But I'll tell you what, I think it's great. I think that it's extremely important. You know, a lot of times they want to hire a big name guy and all that stuff. But I think Pete Lembo is a great fit for this program. He's won every place. He's won at every level. And you know what? He's going to find a way to win at Ball State as well.
For which Lembo says he is forever grateful to Collins for taking that chance.
There was nobody happier last week than Tom Collins, because like all athletic directors, he took a lot of heat over the hire. You know, I mean, they're never going to be happy. I mean, that's just life. That's college athletics.
Ball State going for it on fourth down. Wenning stepping up and running for the first down and then some. And the baseball slide brings him down to the 33-yard line. So Keith Wenning hasn't had a chance to scamper much, but against the second unit, gets off a nice run.
Shows how smart he is here at the end by getting down on the ground. That's the most impressive thing other than getting the first down. Great baseball player, Wenning. I mean, he definitely was a kid that would, you know, a lot of people thought had a future in baseball. I think he's got a future in football. He's a young player. Got a lot of the intangibles. He's got a lot of talent.
Big time arm at 6'4 and 205.
How about the quarterbacks that have played in the Mid-American Conference? You got that guy by the name of Roethlisberger, of course, at Pittsburgh, at Byron Leftwich. I mean, there's been a bunch of them that have been big stars in the National Football League.
Certainly put the Mid-American Conference on the map many years back.
Absolutely. And a lot of people don't realize how good the MAC is. I mean, as a young coach, I coached in that league a long time and learned a lot of football. And I'll tell you what, those MAC schools will jump up and bite you.
Well, today Toledo nearly did that against Ohio State, losing 28-22 in a game in which the Buckeyes had to come from behind on a number of occasions.
Well, that's one of the few bad throws we've seen out of Mr. Winning tonight. That should have been intercepted by Mike June. I mean, he was right there, went right through his hands. Speaking of Mr. June, there he is.
Still playing hard as we have 4 minutes left. Cardinals a step up in class tonight, and it has showed. Ball is loose. Davis caused the fumble, and I think he gets the football to go with it.
Yes, he did. Todd Davis coming off the edge here shows good burst. Nice job, strips the football. That's his second big play of the night now, is Todd Davis. He's a backup. But, you know, Mark Snyder was not real happy with the play of the defensive ends, and maybe Mr. Davis are going to get some more playing time.
Third fumble recovery tonight for Skip Holt's team, which is now a plus six. And giveaways and takeaways for the season, which will certainly put them up among the elite.
Travis Freeman, middle backer for Ball State, that made that last stop. Still playing hard, getting after it. Travis Freeman again. Led the team in tackles, I believe the last 2 years. He played as another one that played as a true freshman.
He once had 16 tackles in a game versus the Iowa Hawkeyes. And 10 tackles last week for Ball State in the win against Indiana.
Sean Baker still in the game, number 25.
And eventually 25 will get that cast off.
Yeah, I hope so, because you know what? He has played, for a one-armed guy, he has played a great football game tonight. I mean, he made a bunch of open field tackles.
Pretty hard for Baker to pick off passes. But it seems like just about every day that cast gets shortened a bit.
Yep. I wonder, he's picking at it. Yeah.
Well, I'll shorten it. Less than 2 minutes remaining. Bulls trying to run wide on this play, and the pile will move the football
wow.
And the player. Another good 7 or 8 yards before they blow the whistle. Ball State again, home next Saturday night to Buffalo.
Marcus Shaw, I'm glad to see him still in the game after that mistake he made. That's the only way you learn.
Army will follow after that, and then a trip to Oklahoma. The Sooners, they're not very good this year, so that ought to be easy.
That should be an easy game.
Oh, wait, Ball State doesn't go empty-handed after tonight. They do get a nice parting check of $650,000, and when they play Oklahoma, they'll receive a $1 million check, and that'll help things in the athletic coffers.
By the way, I have to mention this, speaking of Oklahoma, Bob Stoops was at the funeral.
Yes, he was.
In the service here in Tampa. And, you know, of course, Leroy was maybe even more so at the University of Oklahoma, but beloved out there as well.
Well, all three Selman brothers starring for Oklahoma during their glory years. Somebody was quoted as saying in the Buffalo program tonight, thank the Lord for Mrs. Selman.
Well, that's quite a family. And, you know, Dewey, Leroy's older brother by 11 months, told some great stories about him at the service. One, when Leroy didn't have a date for the prom, and of course Dewey told he had one, but he would take Leroy anyway. So Leroy and Dewey went to the prom. Dewey said, I didn't have a date either. But they went to the prom. They were so shy. Leroy was very shy. They hung around the punch bowl all night, and that's all they did. But they did go to the prom.
War 63 is a member of the Tampa Bay Bucks. Hall of Famer, Ring of Honor. Tomorrow, the Bucks will have a special presentation for Leroy Selman and to honor the 10-year anniversary 9/11. Of 9/11.
Yeah.
This will be quite a day here in Raymond James Stadium.
And, of course, they open with the Lions, and the Lions are roaring. The roar is back in Detroit.
Winning streak toward the end of last year.
Nice penetration by the linebacker right there. That's Justin Cruz, young man from Jacksonville, Florida. I know he's excited to get a chance to play in his home state.
Likely had a number of family members here to watch him.
We thought we might see some of this, some two-back offense from USF with the big old fullback in the game.
Eval shooting one down the field, incomplete at the 20.
Yeah, that's Ty Turner that was in the game at fullback, and Skip talked about that yesterday. Said they were a little dissatisfied with their third and short, and they were going to think about playing some two-back sets, and they had a couple fullbacks in Chris Brait and Ty Turner. They wanted to take a look at that. Boy, no pass rush whatsoever.
And with that incompletion, South Florida now 5 of 14 on third downs tonight, 2 of 14 against Notre Dame. So the numbers are slightly better, but certainly not at the level you want as the
nope,
competition
absolutely
stiffens.
Absolutely not. And again, as Skip mentioned, these three games in a row here, this is all about getting better for South Florida. And that they've done a lot of good things tonight. Daniels was spectacular, but they did a lot of things not very well either. Of course, that's speaking as a coach. You know, you're never satisfied.
That's why we have you in the booth.
Absolutely. Never satisfied. Wow, another big punt. You know, in Brockhouse, he had three punts against Notre Dame down inside the 20-yard line, which was a big factor in that game as well. Peter Voss right there to the left, former head coach in NFL Europe, and bumped heads with him a lot of times over there. I was at Frankfurt. He was at Berlin.
Bet there's some good stories from there, huh?
Oh, wow. What a great league that was. Frankfurt, 50,000-plus fans every week, the wildest fans you've ever seen in your life. It was an amazing experience.
Keith Wenning, number 10, the quarterback for Ball State, set to go the distance.
Of course, you know, and all the backups that are in the game right now for USF, I mean, you know, they want to make a point on why they shouldn't be backups, so they're getting plenty of opportunities.
Possibly the final play of our game. And that will do it, Doug.
Well, you know, Ball State a little bit overmatched tonight. Here you see Coach Lembo and Coach Holtz. But a lot was learned tonight by Ball State, and Coach Holtz would be happy with some things, disappointed with others. That's coaching. They go back to the practice fields on Monday, and they got a lot of work to do before their upcoming Saturday.
These two teams will meet again in Muncie in September of 2012. South Florida scored early and often, got the jump on the opening kickoff on a fumble return, and never looked back. Our final score here in Tampa, South Florida 37 and Ball State 7, as the Bulls go to 2-0 and Ball State drops to a record of 1-1. And for analyst Doug Graber and our entire Big East production crew, I'm Jim Barber. Thank you for watching. And this has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Good night from Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida.